Om Sam Saraswati Namaha. Namaste. Namaste, everyone. On page 39 of the Kashyapa Sutras in the book Srima, the Guru and the Goddess, we're going to begin the discussion of Sutra number 5. And Sutra number 5 is really kind of interesting. It says, Srishtidharmena Jivayatra. So we know Srishti means creation. Srishti is all of existence, all creation. Dharmena is instrumental case of dharma. By means of dharma. By means of dharma. Oh, that says it in the book. By means of dharma, an ideal of perfection. Dharma we are calling the Srishta Adarsh. Now the highest ideal of perfection is your dharma. In every circumstance. So, everybody will define that dharma, that highest ideal of perfection, according to their own aspirations, according to their own experience. What is your highest ideal of perfection? Now, for me, I would like to proclaim that when I do a job with one-pointed attention, with love in my heart, with considering the people for whom I'm doing that job, with no selfish interest for me, only trying to do the best perfect job, I consider that my dharma, my highest ideal of perfection. If I'm adding up a column of numbers, I want to come to the right answer. I don't want to tape 2 pennies at the bottom of a ledger and say, call it good. I want my books to balance to the penny. This is my dharma. If I'm washing the dishes, I don't want to put a dirty spoon in the clean dish rack. I want to say, I inspected my work and I am putting everything, only the clean things get put away. You know, if you put a dirty spoon, is Jhuta. And if you put a Jhuta item in the box with all the clean items, then all the items are Jhuta. Interesting, if you're sitting in Puja or sitting and chanting the Chandi and you take a drink of water, your hand is Jhuta, because the hand was touching the bottle, and the bottle was touching the water, and the water was touching your mouth. And therefore, according to the rules of Ucchishta, if you drink while you're chanting, then you gotta get up, wash your hands, and then come back and do Achman and Ashanshudhi all over again. And in some traditions, you have to start over again. In other traditions, they give you a pass and say, you can continue from where you left off. This is how we define dharma, the highest ideal of perfection for each individual in each circumstance. So the harmony of the universe, the religion, The religare is the Latin for religion upon which we rely upon. We rely upon, we dedicate ourselves to these principles. This is our religion. The way of truth and light and harmony. This is our dharma, our Srishta Adarsh, the highest ideal perfection. A jiva means the individual soul, the jivatma. As compared with the Paramatma, the Supreme Soul, the soul within this container is Jiva. So the individual life force, the individual as contrasted with the universal existence, the individual as a separate entity of divinity, a separate expression of divinity. So I'm different from the rest, is the Jiva. And yatra is a pilgrimage or journey. And jiva yatra is the journey of the individual soul. Each one of us is making our own individual journey, our own individual pilgrimage, our own individual process until we reach union with the Supreme. So this creation is a collection of individual souls who are making their own personal pilgrimages by means of the laws of harmony and unity, of peace and truth. Or we could say that Dharma comes about in this creation when every individual soul strives in its pilgrimage towards perfection. That also is another application. So the Jivayatra is the pilgrimage of every individual soul in accordance with the principles of Dharma. It's Dharma, it's ideal of perfection. There is no one who is not on the path. Everyone who has a manifested existence is somewhere on the path. Either they're going towards the goal or they're going away from the goal, but they're on the path. All individuals are making a Jivayatra in accordance with the principles of Dharma. And some people think, my highest ideal of perfection is to become the best thief. Or my highest ideal of perfection is to become the best sadhu. They're still on the path. They're still making this Jivayatra, this pilgrimage towards the definition of their goal. Everyone is moving towards their goal. So there is no one who is not on the path. Every individual soul is progressing in accordance with its own Dharma. And we have no right to be judgmental about others, even if it appears that they lack harmony or balance. This is their chosen ideal of behavior because there is only Dharma in the Srishti. They have an ideal of perfection. I want to become the best thief. I want to become the best liar. I want to become the best dishwasher. I want to become the best sadhu. Everyone has their own definition of what they want to become the best at. And that's their Jivayatra. So everyone is acting in order to fulfill their own personal goals of perfection. One may want to become a perfect thief, another the perfect saint, but all are seeking perfection. And no matter whatever you do, the creation has come about in order to fulfill the quest for perfection. To our limited prejudice, perceptions, we may think that others require greater harmony in their lives. In reality, they are only fulfilling their own dharma, which is the dharma of their particular yatra. They are making a pilgrimage towards perfection, and their goal is defined as the perfect mathematician, the perfect musician, the perfect sadhu, the perfect saint. So, the creation has come about in order to fulfill the quest for perfection. In reality, everyone is fulfilling their dharma, which is the dharma, the definition of the ideal of perfection of their particular pilgrimage. And Ma says that if you can renounce all attachment to your actions, you are acting in accordance with dharma. There are so many levels of meaning of Dharma. Some people speak of Dharma as religion. Are you a Hindu, a Muslim, a Christian, a Buddhist, or a Jew? Other people speak of Dharma as the universal laws of nature. Everything in between is included in the definition. On every level of the evolution of consciousness, you will find an expanded definition until you are one with God. And then you will know the real meaning of Dharma. In one sense, Dharma is a duty. In another sense, it is a religion. In another sense, it is a natural law. In another sense, it is an ideal for which to strive. Again, it is an ideal to manifest without striving. Your natural behavior, your intrinsic nature, your swabhav. Aristotle called it the inner necessity to become. It is entelechy. You have this magnetic attraction to become something more than you are. Something greater, to aspire, to reach towards the manifestation of that ultimate whatever it is. Dharmena, that is what creates this movement. This constant reaching out to manifest a greater perfection, a greater harmony, a greater ideal. Well, currently, I like to translate Dharma as the ideal of perfection, because every atom of existence has its own ideal of perfection towards which it is striving. Every individual soul is destined to manifest its own ideal of perfection. We can't all manifest the same ideal. So, Dharmena is its individual path, and every individual form has its own. Until ultimately, when we become one with God, we become one with all Dharma. And all join in the realization of divinity. If we act with attachment in duality, then we can only produce egotistical or attached behavior. If we can surrender that action free from attachment, we can aspire to live in accordance with the laws of universal Dharma. It's not only for me. I'm not the only beneficiary of my actions. My actions create a greater harmony and a greater unity and a greater benefit to more and more by uplifting more and more people in my sphere of influence. But once upon a time, there reigned in the kingdom of Pataliputra a very righteous king by the name of Chandrasena, who governed his subjects with the loving and gentle guidance of a father to his children. That king had a very devoted and enlightened minister who was also his best friend and confidant. His name was Uttam. No matter what happened in the functions of government and the personal lives of the king and his family, even in the minister's own life, no matter what course events would take, that minister used to say, God performs all works for the best. It is God's will. Occasionally, when things would go very, very wrong in the kingdom, and the worst results came to pass, that minister, Uttam, would say, don't worry, it's for the best. God has a plan, and he designs all for the best possible results. This used to irritate King Chandrasena. He was constantly, frequently perplexed by numerous problems. Problems with enemies, with finance, with treasury, with spies sowing the seeds of dissension, the potential of drought. For the ruler of a kingdom, almost anything and everything can go wrong at any time, and it usually does. And in the midst of this havoc, while dealing with all of these difficulties, his minister would say, don't worry. God does everything for the best. Protect your Dharma, O King. Do what is right. Do I have to listen to this? Thought the king. What nonsense this man offers. Again and again when we have problems, he tells me not to worry. It's all God's will. How can I run a kingdom like that? I've got decisions to make. My decisions will affect the lives of all the citizens of my kingdom. I can't just say, hey, citizens, it's God's will. Don't worry. Well, one day, the king was eating from a basket of fruit, and he selected a fresh, juicy, red apple from the basket, and taking his knife, he began to peel it. As he was peeling it, his knife slipped. Ow! He shouted. and he licked the wound where a slight trace of blood began to appear. "Darn it, that hurt!" cried the king. The passive minister, when he saw the king's predicament, calmly replied, "Don't worry, it's all right. God has a plan. Everything is for the best." "What do you mean it's for the best?" cried the king. "That's my finger that's bleeding. Everything is not for the best. What is so good about the king cutting his finger? Guards, throw this idiot in jail." Immediately, the guards came and arrested the minister, and they took him to the jail. King Chandrasena was very fond of hunting. He and his friend Uttam, the minister, used to go out every afternoon in the forest to shoot at game, to enjoy the freshness of the outdoors, and to get away from the stuffiness and the considerations of the kingdom. And this day, King Chandrasena's mind would not sit still. Being so agitated, he went off into the forest by himself. He started to shoot at some of the animals, but because of his lack of concentration, he could not hit anything. Just then, a giant boar came running into his path. The king pursued the boar on horseback, following him into the denseness of the forest. The boar went on, darting in and out between the thickets with deceitful treachery. And he led the king far into the dense forest, away from every area which the king had previously visited. Suddenly, in the thick part of a forest, a band of tribal natives surrounded King Chandrasena. With weapons drawn and aimed at him, they made him stop in a clearing. "Dismount from your horse," they commanded. The king got down from his horse, surrendered his arms, and was taken captive. The warriors brought their prisoner to their high priest. "Ah," he exclaimed, "an excellent victim for our sacrifice. Wash him, give him food. Tonight the goddess of death will be pleased. We can sacrifice this noble head before our goddess." The king was led away, bathed, dressed in the finest cloth, fed a scrumptious meal, and then bound to the sacrificial post. The priest began to recite the sacrificial text, while the members of the tribe gathered round, chanting in the ecstasy of worship. The executioner raised the blade of the sword over the king's head. "Stop," said the high priest. "What's that on his thumb?" "It's a cut. This victim is not whole. He cannot be sacrificed. He has an imperfection, and our goddess will not accept him. Release him." The king was released, and immediately he made his way back home to his kingdom. After taking some refreshment and rest, he sent for the minister, Uttam. "Bring the minister from the jail." When the minister was brought before the king, Chandrasena related what had happened to him during his adventure in the forest. The king said, "Now I understand what you said to be true, that God works everything for the best. I can see that the cut on my thumb, in fact, saved my life from being sacrificed before the goddess of those natives in the forest. But now, you please clarify for me one point. If God has a plan for everything, and everything is for the best in accordance with Dharma, then tell me, how was it for the best for you to spend the day in jail? Uttam, the minister, gave his reply. Your Highness, you know you are very fond of hunting in the afternoons, of wandering in the forest to shoot game, and to seek refuge from the considerations of the kingdom. Regularly, I accompany you on these hunting expeditions. On this particular day, you were saved. You were caught by native tribesmen and were ready to, who were ready to offer you in sacrifice to their goddess, and you were saved by the cut on your finger. Well, Your Highness, I had no cut on my finger. Had I accompanied you into the forest, I might well, very well have been required to leave my head in the very same place. So you see, Your Highness, God works everything for the best. He has a plan for all. Let us surrender to God's will, and then we can see how His plan will unfold in bringing us to the ultimate realization of our Dharma.
Thank you.
Srishtidharmena, by means of Dharma, this entire creation is, all the individual souls within this entire creation are making their journey, their pilgrimage through life. Srishtidharmena Jivayatra. Om Sam Sarasvati Namaha. Let's see if there are any questions.
We have a question from Ambika.
Namaste, Ambika.
Do we only have one unchanging path of Dharma in our lifetime, or is it something that changes and transforms over time, like, for example, the kind of work we do in the world?
Moment to moment. Not even one over your lifetime, not one over the day. But sometimes you are mother, and you are the ideal of perfection of mother. And sometimes you are chaplain, and you are the ideal of perfection of chaplain. Sometimes you are the cook, and so you are the ideal of perfection of cooking. And sometimes you are the enjoyer of the food, and you are the ideal enjoyer. You are the yogi, the bogey. You wear so many hats in your life, and you are seeking perfection in every action, in every cause, in every relationship. So it's constantly changing your definition of Dharma. How can I manifest perfection here? With Dharma, by means of Dharma, my individual soul is making its yatra in this creation. It's making a pilgrimage through creation until I reach the highest ideal of perfection to which I can aspire. In every relationship, in every action, in every function, I'm seeking that highest Dharma. With Dharma, I'm moving.
We have a question from Elijah.
Namaste, Elijah.
How can we cultivate a greater acceptance for the Dharma of others? You and Srimal do this extremely well, but it seems to be a problem with many other ideologies.
Well, don't follow the other ideologies. Follow the examples before you that work. If you see it working for Ma and me, then try it in your own life. Accept everyone where they are. We have in a sadhu's jhola, this is called the jhola. A little bag, every sadhu carries a little bag, and sometimes they're really small, and electronic sadhus that got to carry the iPad and their iPhone and their laptop, and they got a bigger jhola. But a jhola is your purse, your bag, your where you keep your stuff. And a sadhu actually has three possessions in his bag. If I reach into my bag, I can pull out. First amongst them is pure love. First item in my bag, pure love. And pure love means I accept you where you are. I pay attention to you and accept you, and I have no criticism, I have no comment. You are where you're at, and I accept you. Come, you're welcome. I accept you where you are. I have no criticism for you. And the second thing you'll find in your sadhu's bag is inspiration. Inspiration says, do you know if you could try to do it a little differently, you could find new ways of making your ideal of perfection manifest. So you have pure love, inspiration, and the third ingredient is appreciation. I appreciate every effort you make to do whatever it is you're doing in the furtherance of your definition of Dharma. And those are the three things that a sadhu has in his jhola: pure love, inspiration, appreciation. And that's how we function in this world. I can't meet you the first time and say, okay, I think you should become different. I'm going to remake you in the image of someone I like. That's not pure love. I'm putting up barriers. Pure love says I'm tearing down all the barriers. I don't care where you're coming from. You are who you are. I'm welcoming you and accepting you in your present state. Now, do I have anything that I could share with you which could inspire within you some desire to change? To improve yourself, to change yourself, to make yourself into a different individual? Could I give you that inspiration? Can I communicate that inspiration to you? And if you accept that communication and you actually make any effort to change, or to improve, or to evolve, or to move into a new direction, I appreciate. My goodness, I appreciate. I've got pure love, inspiration, and appreciation. That's all I got in my bag. The rest you can have. As long as I get to keep those three ingredients, I will be a wealthy man wherever I go. That's the wealth of a sadhu. Those three ingredients, please, write them down. Pure love, inspiration, appreciation, the three assets that a sadhu owns. Now, if you have those three ingredients, you can be a sadhu. You'll be efficient. You'll focus your attention with love and joy. You'll do your work with efficiency because you've got the vav. You got the juice. And that's the objective. Elijah. So we don't want to change what your values are. We want to empower you to achieve your values. We're not trying to define your goals. We're not trying in the least to define your goals. We're trying to show you what our definition is for ourselves and invite you to come in and look at it. And if you like it, we'll show you what we do, how we do it, and what it means, and how will it affect your lives. And if you're not interested, namaste, take blessings, eat lunch, and go home.
Eat lunch in the
Devi
Mandir kitchen.
Yeah, eat lunch in the Devi Mandir kitchen. We used to call it Durga's Diner.
We have a related question from Nanda.
Namaste, Nandama.
Does pure love, I accept you where you are, mean that we do not try to change anyone or influence them in any way? Please help me understand.
What we try to do, Nanda, is show them what we're doing. If they came to see us, they came for a reason. They came to see us because they have an idea that if they watch our behavior, they may learn something. They may be inspired to change in some way.
And also pure love is detached. They don't like to take anything, they like to give.
Pure love has detachment. It's only about giving, not about exchanging or what am I going to get in return. Pure love just says, here, I'm here to share with you. If you like to come and learn with me, you're welcome. It doesn't mean that I'm going to go to you and teach you the error of your ways and make you into the image of my perfection. What ego! What attachment! I have no right to demand that from any other being. If you come to my house and you want to see what I do, I will show you. That's my love. Not that I'm going to go to your house and show you how you did it wrong or criticize you. So, no, I don't seek to change anybody. If you want to change yourself according to the functions that Ma and I perform, you will do so. And if you want information or some inspiration or some understanding of what we do and why we do it that way and what it means and how to apply it, certainly ask the question. We will more than happily share the answers that come to us. But for us to go out and say, you have to change? Absolutely not. Who am I to tell any other party how they should live their life? What is their dharma? How can I define dharma for any other individual? I have enough trouble understanding it for myself. What is my highest ideal of perfection? That's something I have to answer for me. You can't answer for me. Well, I think you should chant Hare Krishna. Thank you. Namaste. I would say, well, no, I have an inner urge to become one with the Divine Mother. I love to worship Shiva. I love to worship Srima. I love to pattern my life after the example that I see in front of me. The grace and the flow and the service and the pure love, which wants nothing more than to make piles of food and feed everybody who comes and share with everybody she can her love and her grace and her generosity.
We have a question from Sadhana Shakti.
Namaste, Sadhana.
If we drink water during puja, but we have such deep devotion, wouldn't that override it being Jhuta?
No. Sorry. Now, I only explain that as an illustration of what are the laws and what are the rules, and I never proclaim that anybody has to adhere to the rules. But as we are seeking greater states of perfection, we're going to control all of our bodily urges and bodily functions while we are pursuing our unit communion with God. Which means I'm going to sit in one asana. I'm only going to have communion with my text and my deity and myself. There's only three of us. There are the mantras and the God and the worshiper. And I'm not going to think about getting, about the cramp in my foot, about moving my knees, about straining my back, about wiggling here and there, about dancing the hoochie coo. I'm not going to think about swatting flies or chasing mosquitoes or swatting a spider. I'm just going to think about God. Now, I'm going to control my urge to urinate as I increase my asana. The more water we take in, the more water comes out. Sorry about that. Law of nature. When we do longer sankalpas with trying to expand the length of our asana, you'll find that it's necessary to reduce the amount of water that you consume. So that many times when I was doing longer asanas, meaning 7 or 8 or 10 hours in one posture, then I would take maybe a quarter of a cup of water in the morning and a quarter of a cup of water in the evening, and I would dry out my body so I didn't have an urge to get up and urinate. Because that's a problem. I mean, that's an easy way to break your asana, especially after 3 or 4 hours, you say, oh my gosh, I gotta go. Or, I gotta clean up a big mess here. So as you get deeper and deeper, you're not allowed to do that in the temple too, I wanna let you know. So if you gotta go, you gotta get up and go, because you're not allowed just to sit in the temple and make the mess. Fact of life. All the Brahmins will come and they'll throw buckets of water and clean up the mess before you even get up.
I don't think anybody will do that
either. But the point is that there are rules that we want to, as we go deeper and deeper into the tradition and the culture and the bhavana of tapasya, and we expand the asana, then anything, any personal function, even scratching, is a little bit out of the ordinary. You're not allowed to twitch your nose, and you're not allowed to poke your ear, and you're not allowed to scratch down below, and all these other movements are going to be controlled. We will become as still as the image that we are worshiping. Which means that we're going to control all the bodily functions. Now, I'm not saying right now that that's a necessity, but sadhana, I know how many different functions you are performing. You have 2 jobs, you go to school full time, you take care of a household and a husband and a community, and you support your congregation, and you support and you're doing sadhana at the same time. I've never told you that you can't drink water while you're doing your prayer. However, there will come a time when you graduate and you're only doing your prayer, and then we're going to say, okay, here are some more rules that you have to adhere to, or that you're going to want to adhere to in accordance with the customs and the traditions of doing tapasya. You will reduce the amount of personal bodily functions that are performed while you are doing your sadhana.
What if we had some illness, if we were just sick that day that required us to keep getting up? Would we keep restarting the puja, or?
Probably not. If it's an illness that day that makes you keep getting up, you'll probably just keep going back down and doing Achman Asan Sudhi and then starting from where you left off. That would be okay. However, if it's something that's recurring on a regular basis, you're going to want to make this the rhythm of sadhana that works for you, and then you're going to want to expand it. And when we start expanding it, we call it, it's no longer sadhana, it's tapasya. So the sadhana evolves into a tapasya, where I am really stretching and pushing out the boundaries, the limits of my capacity. And I'm expanding the asana, I'm expanding the pranayama, I'm expanding the length of the recitation, I'm in expansion mode. And correspondingly, there's a decrease in the amount of water that I take, there's a decrease in the amount of calories that I consume, there's a decrease in the amount of urination that I do, there's a decrease in the amount of rest that I take. I'm getting my energy from someplace else. And that's the tapasya. Yes, please.
What if our goal is to become one with God, but for some reason, we're limited in our body and cannot expand our asana?
You'll do the best you possibly can and try to do better, and then hope that next life you start from where you left off this life. But you're not going to achieve that sense of communion, what we're calling samadhi. You're not going to achieve that samadhi as long as your body is dancing. As long as your body is twitching and moving, and you're getting up to drink, and you're getting up to pee, and you're getting up and you're dancing the hoochie coo while you're sitting there, it's not probable. You can live a very, very beautiful life. You can live a very religious life. You can live a philosophical life. You can live a serviceful life, but you're not going to go into the highest states of samadhi until you can sit still.
So when Ramakrishna, what state was he in when he saw the birds and he went into some...
He was in Bhav Samadhi. There was him and the birds and the activity that was being performed, the sense of beauty, the sense of communion. He went into Bhav Samadhi. No question, there was three. But then he went into Nirvikalpa Samadhi when Totapuri poked him in the third eye, and then he just went, he was gone for 2 or 3 days and didn't move from his asana. Now that was a different kind of samadhi from when he saw the birds and saw the beauty of the nature. It's not the same. Now I definitely say you can see birds. I hope they are not angry birds, but you can see birds even if you can't sit.
But you can go into Bhav Samadhi.
You can go into Bhav Samadhi even while you're washing the dishes. I'm so much in love with my guru that this dish is a reflection of the purity and clarity. It shines to me. And if you can get into that love affair with that dish and become submerged in the bhava and the intensity of the reality of your love affair with your guru, then you can go into Bhav Samadhi. But if you're talking about going into Nirvikalpa Samadhi where there's only one, I don't think it's possible until you can sit still. There are distinctions, and we've talked about them. Salokya, Samipya, Sarupya, Sadrishya, Sayuj. And you will not go into Sayuj if you can't sit still. You can have a very beautiful life. You can have a religious life. You can have a devoted life. You can be a great devotee. You can be a great bhakta. But if you want to be sitting like Shiva's sitting, or you want to be blessing the universe like Durga's blessing, then you're going to have to sit like Durga. You'll want to sit like Shiva. She never closes her eyes for a moment. Elijah, that was the practice of Tratak that we were talking about the other day. The practice of keeping your eyes open and letting her see right into your soul.
We have a question from Ananda Shakti.
Namaste, Ananda Shakti.
Does free will exist? And if so, how does it work with the idea of God's will directing everything?
Ananda Shakti, free will is the property of Lord Shiva, our Father. And the God is directing everything is the property of the fruit of our karma, is what we're going to receive, which is the property of our mother, the goddess Parvati. And we are the children of both goddess Parvati and Lord Shiva, mom and pop. And always we are going to get the fruit of our karma, and oftentimes we have a willpower and a free will to change that karma. So it automatically will change the fruit that we receive. So both are true. We have a free will to change it. If we take a sankalpa and we say we're going to do this kind of tapasya and this kind of sadhana, I will not accept the limitations of my body. I'm going to train my body to do more. If we have that attitude, then we will prevail. We will not necessarily accept the fruit of our karma. We will make efforts to change it.
Question from Chandana.
Namaste, Chandana.
According to Sri Ma, what does it mean to realize God?
Sri Ma can answer that. Tumar basha diye, bakya kurun, ye bostame porinote ki mone ache. She doesn't know. Next question.
We have a question from Vivekananda.
Yes, Vivek, namaste.
If one of our ideals of perfection is to one day chant the chani in full, forwards and backwards, with some puts and the extras attached, but intense emotions assail us when we even think about beginning from square one, is dealing with these emotions a form of tapasya? And will they subside and let us merge into the chanting at some time? Or do they?
Yes, yes, and yes. Absolutely. First of all, your sankalpa will allow you to train yourself to sing the chandi forwards and backwards with the prayoga and the upasanga puja. I used to do it 9 times in one day. I would do it 7 times in one asana. And I started from less than where you are. Now, the second thing, will you be able to control your emotions? Yes, definitely. What happens, Vivek, as you try to sing the chandi from cover to cover, or forwards and backwards, or using some puts or not using some, every time you try to do something new and expand it, then what do you desire? I desire to expand my sadhana, I desire to expand my tapasya. I don't want to go out and dance the hoochie-coo. And I don't want to go to the party. I want to go to the temple and sit down and check. So you're expanding not only your asana and your capacity, your pranayama, your understanding, but you're expanding your desire. It becomes more intense, more real. Well, that desire becomes more intensely real to you. It's your bhava. What? Now, given an option, okay, guys, today is our day off. We could go to the party. We could go to the sporting event. We could go to the bar. We could go dancing. We could go to the temple and sit down and chant the chandi from cover to cover, forwards and backwards, and with the samputs. Which do you choose to do? And that's the answer to the question. All the emotions, all the desires, all the feelings, all that outside wandering mind gets collected into the desire to be one with Chandi, and to be one with God, and to do the tapasya, and to feel that bhava, and feel that power, and feel that strength, and understand what it is I'm doing, and why I'm doing it, what does it mean, and how's it going to change my life. And the third thing is, when we start doing this kind of sadhana, all the understanding, all the intuitive meanings become awakened for us. And every discovery becomes more and more fascinating. It attracts us. It's got the pure love. It's got that bhavana. And we go deeper and deeper into the bhavana, the understanding, the feeling, the intensity of the reality. This is my reality, and the rest of this is bakwas. It's all nonsense. My reality comes here, and I go to sleep at night and dream I chanted the chandi, and I wake up in the morning and do purnahuti and take a shower and go chant it again. It becomes chandi patal divaratral kurya deva na sangshaya. Na sangshaya, without a doubt. If you do the chandi in the day and in the night, you become divine, without a doubt. It's true, Vivek. So you get it in the gross body, you get it in the subtle body, you get it in the causal body, and pretty soon it's yours. And that's the way we want to get it. So it's mine. I'm not reading stuff out of a book that some swami on a mountaintop said, go ahead and read this, it'll be good for you. I'm doing the thing that I want to do most in my life. Becoming best dharmena. Srishtidharmena Jivayatra. By means of my dharma, with my highest ideal of perfection, I'm making this pilgrimage through life towards my ultimate goal, and that's my creation. Srishtidharmena Jivayatra. So yes, Vivek, it is possible, it is probable, and I encourage you, I inspire you, I request you, I demand in every way I possibly can.
It is true?
It is true, it is true, satyam, satyam, nashamshaya. it is true, there is no particle of doubt. I abjure you. You please, with all of your capacity, love her, please her, worship her, and use all the tools at your disposal to come closer and closer and closer to manifesting that ideal of perfection.
We love you, Vivek.
Namaste.
We have a question from Nanda.
Nandama!
If doing sadhana means we control our emotions, then does an inability to control our emotions mean that we are not doing sadhana?
Oh yeah, very clearly. very clearly, when we are doing sadhana, then we are in control. We become efficient sadhus who are performing the necessary practices by which we control our emotions. We control our wandering minds. We bring our minds back and we've defined the goal and we have a clear understanding that that's my goal and this is the path and this is my jivayatra. This is the pilgrimage of my soul towards my path. I'm not attached to the past. I'm not projecting to the future. I just want to do the sadhana that make the jivayatra by means of dharma. My highest ideal of perfection isn't to live in the past and cling to dreams that I had experienced so many years ago. My highest ideal of perfection is become one with the guru and one with the goddess and become the person I most highly respect. Not someone who is scattered, or not someone who's confused, and not someone who is bemused, and not someone who is amused. We just want to become one with the guru and one with the goddess. And everything that helps us get there, our assets, and everything that takes us away, namaste, thank you for coming and inviting me into your life, but I've got business to do. I've got a function to fulfill, and my function is to continue on the jivayatra, the pilgrimage of this individual soul towards my ultimate goal, my lakshya. I'm not stopping till I get there.
We have a question from Samantha.
Namaste, Samantha. Namaste, Kyle.
How can we keep our eyes open without the urge to blink like the deities?
Samantha, do you know there is a king named Nimi? Now, Nimi did a tremendous tapasya. I don't have time to tell the whole story like I told you about Chandrasena. However, Nimi did a tremendous tapasya. And Brahma came to him and said, what boon do you want? And Nimi said, I want to sit on the eyeballs of everyone who meditates and make them nim, which means blink. I want to make them blink. And Brahma said, why would you want that? I mean, what kind of a boon is that? And Nimi said, well, when they blink, they have to remember me. That means everybody who tries to meditate is going to look through their eyes and I'm going to make them blink and they'll remember. Oh, that's King Nimi. And I will be the most remembered and most revered king of all the kings. And Brahma said, I'm going to give you that boon, but you will not be able to make sadhus blink who keep their eyes open in Thratak. And what's going to happen is a tear is going to come in their eye and wash you away. So, Samantha, what we do in Thratak is look the deity in the eye, because the eyes are the window to the soul, and we watch, and I invite her to look into my soul. I have nothing to hide, and I have no place to hide it anyway, even if I tried, but I have nothing to hide. Please, Ihagacha Ihatishta, come here and look into my soul, and I'm going to look at you and look at you and look at you until you make me cry. And when I cry, the tears are going to wash away in King Nimi, and I can stay there with my eyes open and never blink until the goddess sends me back. So that's a practice that we acquire by performing the tapasya of Thratak. Looking her straight eye to eye. Your mouth says many words. Listen to that, Swami. He goes on and on, day after day, hour after hour. He can say so many things, but open your eyes and show me your heart. And if I look into your heart, I can tell the sincerity just by what your eyes are telling me. I can tell you the sincerity. I can tell what with what sincerity are you speaking these many words. Is this a prepared speech that you've memorized for the last 42 years and you're giving this lecture all the time, you're reading out of a book, or is this something that's coming from your heart? Open your eyes. The eyes are a window to your soul. Just look me in the eye and tell me that. So Samantha, that's the story of King Nemi. And if you can flush him out with your tears, then he will go away. He won't be able to make you blink. You'll be able to sit there hour after hour after hour. And that is one stage in the process of coming into meditation. Deeper and deeper and deeper. I control my bodily functions. I control my intake of water. I control the outflow of water. I control the movement of my body. I control the movement of my mind. I look you in the eye and you can tell the sincerity with which I'm saying what I'm saying. And then I even cry. And that's another form of understanding where we are in the progress, in the Jivayatra with Dharma. Using our Dharma, by means of Dharma, Dharmena, Srishtidharmena Jivayatra. Along with Dharma, by means of Dharma, in pursuit of Dharma, we are making the pilgrimage of this individual soul. Yes, please.
We have a question from Nanda.
Namaste, Nanda Maha.
Please tell me how I can surrender every action to live in accordance to my Dharma. Is it a constant reaffirmation of I surrender this action to you?
Yes, but in every moment, kalkashta, every kshana, every moment of time, every breath, the greatest sin that we can perform is to take a breath without saying thank you. Now, when you get there, we'll talk again. Strive for that one. Why would you take God's breath, God's air, put the oxygen into your lungs without saying thank you? That's the sin, the original sin. I thought something else. Remember, ekvivaham jagat yatra dvitiyam na mama para. There is not a second. There is none other than me. How can you take my breath away from me to yourself without saying thank you? Cheater. When we get there, we can talk about the next step, Nanda. In the meantime, be content with small gains. There are little things we can do. Puja, pot, home, sangeet, nrit.
I like that minister talk.
It's all for the best. But I didn't have a cut on my finger. Nanda, don't go for the gold. Be content with small steps. Be content to pay attention when you're in puja. Be content to pay attention when you're reciting your pot. Be content to pay attention when you're doing japa and in meditation. And then attach a mantra to all the other functions you perform in life. Say thank you or bless me before you leave the house. Say Ganesha's name when you cross the threshold of the door. Say the Nivarna mantra when you turn on the key to your car. Say Durga's name when you open your computer. Say Shiva's name when you sit down. Say Vishnu's name when you stand up. Say a prayer for dinner, say a prayer for a glass of water, say a prayer for every single thing you do. There's a mantra attached to every action. Nanda, you will be made perfect. Om Sam Sarasvati Namaha. Namaste.
Fine. Very good.